Prophecy Headlines, 9 June 2021. And this is the slide I always pop up to show just how close we are, because oftentimes we lose the understanding of how many things have already been fulfilled. And really, everything is aligned. The rapture can occur at any moment. We have a number of things that we're watching, but really the things that are remaining are those things at the very end. So we are awaiting the one world government and the one world religion in prep for the temple. And we already have the Ezekiel 38 and 39 players that are identified in the, and they've got their teams lined up. So what we're doing now is just waiting for a trigger event and watch ourselves moving inch and inch closer to when the Lord will return for his church in the air. Amen. I look forward to that day. So here we are. I'm going to bring a few things that are occurring as we move in that transition closer to seeing our Lord face to face. This one occurred in England. My world fell apart, school chaplain accused of terrorism over LGBTQ sermon, and says he will not be silenced. And amen to him. But that sounds odd, doesn't it? You preach what the Bible says, and you are ostracized. You are in the potential of losing your job, in losing your livelihood, because you preach the Word of God against one of the many abominations that are out there, and you have the chance of losing your job. Now, again, like I said, this was in England. We also had ministers up in Canada that were preaching when they were told to close your church and don't open it up. Well, they defied that and they were arrested. So more and more we are seeing this pushback. And we talked about it earlier, that you cannot say anything. And there's supposedly hate speech is what the Bible teaches. Now, the Bible is the most inclusive book there is in the world, in that everyone is a sinner and everyone needs a Savior. So we'll take all sinners, every one of them. And you know how many sinners there are in the world? Every one of them, 100% of the people in the world are sinners, whether they admit it or not. So here in this situation, we see us just a glimpse of what is going to happen as we move closer to this one world government, one world religion that will demand this as a standard. They will accept everyone and everything you want to believe in, besides people who are Christians, and if there are any at this time, these are the tribulation saints, who believe that only the Bible is the Word of God and only Jesus Christ is the Messiah.
Amen.
Everything else will be accepted. You can believe in, worship frogs or dogs or cats or statues of wood or metal or stone, and all those things, believe it or not, are occurring right now in the world, whether you know it or not. We've seen some monkey worship when we went over to, what was it, Nepal. Nepal. They were worshiping monkeys. So you can see all these different things out there right now. So when you read in Revelation, it says they refuse to worship the things that were created. That is a fact. In the United States, you don't see people bow down and worshiping cows or monkeys or anything else.
Yet.
But it's there. We saw that in India. Cows are sacred. So I like my cows, but I'm not praying to my cow. So anyway, this is coming, and this will be this one world religion. Now, the thing that will be eye-opening for many of the people at this time, if you live during the tribulation, if you reach that 3.5 year point in the mid-tribulation, you'll see you can worship anything, till you'll see the Antichrist stand up and say, wrong, I'm God, you will worship me alone. And if you don't do that, you will face beheading. You either take worship the beast and get his mark, or you will be starved, marched off to camps, executed. So that's what's coming. So when you see this one chaplain who preached one LGBTQ sermon, what the Bible says, and he loses his job, know that that is but a drip in the coming ocean of hatred that will be against Christians. And I would ask at this time if you could turn down your phones.
Crickets.
Put it on vibrator, whatever. I've had a couple of people say that. Why don't you tell people to turn off their phones? I did it there. So anyway, next. Now, this is Ezekiel 38 and 39, war preparations and players. If you, you know, this was a page off the Middle East, off the Jerusalem Post. You see Iran, Iraq and Iran are one soul with two bodies. So you're seeing a shift in Iran. You know, right now America's in there. We got troops in there. We're defending them. But more and more we're getting attacks. And that's what I show right here. Iran provides in Iraq increased drone war against U.S. forces. That is a fact. We are seeing that more and more. Also, the one down below there, it says the third major Iranian infrastructure attack in the last 2 weeks. So there are mysterious attacks going on in Iran with their infrastructure. Anyone speculate where that's coming from? Bad luck. Exactly what I was going to say. They're having some bad luck right now. No, right now it has been an undeclared war between the Iranian regime and Israel. So they're not going to come right out and say it, but as we've said in here, this proxy war has been going on for years, and it will continue to go on. Now, it's even worse because the United States has now pulled out of the relationship they once had with Israel, and they're replacing it with a cozier relationship with the Iranians and all their proxies, Hamas, Hezbollah, Syria. All of those are cozying up now to our current regime in the United States. So what is that doing? Well, if you read Ezekiel 38, 39 war, you'll see it says Sheba, Dedan, and the traders of Tarshish. Here we have Sheba, which is Saudi Arabia, and Dedan, which is UAE, are now feeling abandoned by the United States again, who is shifting their focus to making this Iranian nuclear deal for whatever reason. And they're understanding there will be relationships now that they have to develop with the Iranians. So what does that do? Well, if you go back and read Ezekiel, you'll see that, you know, the Iranians, the Russians, and the Turks all come together in this war. And there are sideline setting nations that are out there that are not participating and setting back instead and saying, what are you going to do? Why is that? Because the Iranians will be allowed to have a nuclear weapon. And they are crazy enough to use them. And that's the issue that's going to come up. These people, the Arabians and UAE, know that. So now they're deciding that they have to discuss this with their enemy. And they are a bigger enemy with the Iranians than they are with the Israelis. However, with the United States pulling out of the equation, what else are they supposed to be doing? So that's going on there. Israel. There's a great divide in Israeli politics. This reminds me of another nation that had two diametrically opposed positions. You might have heard of them. One was Trump and the other was Biden. We had that go on. There was such acrimony and hatred and vicious press. Well, they're repeating that on the other side of the ocean in Israel. And they have a coalition that is formed now. And that coalition, for the first time, contains Muslims in it. So you have Israel, and you have it is including moderate Arabs, or Muslims, if there is such a name. And they are within this new government that is forming. There is a lot of speculation out there that this new government is the one that is going to sign the seven-year treaty with the Antichrist. And again, Daniel 9:27 says, as the prince who shall come shall make a covenant with many. Well, that many is Jews, because if you looked at the beginning, it says to Daniel, I will tell you what shall happen to your people. And that many are the Jews. Doesn't say all the Jews, doesn't say most of the Jews, it says many of the Jews. So these Jews are potentially the ones that will make the deal with the Antichrist. Why do I say that? Netanyahu is not going down with a fight. The hate against Bibi Netanyahu is as great as it was against Trump. There is real hatred out there. And if you look at their reporting, there's a huge number of people that hate him. And they want to replace him with the most liberal government that they've ever had in Israel. The hardline conservatives, the ones that are the Torah scholars and the Old Testament believers, are with Benjamin Netanyahu, and they do not support this change in government at all. So I think from this crowd, the ones that are Torah savvy, this is the group that is going to become, going to rise out, that one-third Jews that will believe that Jesus Christ is their Messiah during this 3.5 tribulation period. So this is all kind of going on in these headlines if you know what the scripture says. And again, there will be a change in the government that will allow, in Israel, that will allow the signature with the Antichrist. I entitle this Lies, Lies, and More Lies. What other lies are we being told? So the reason I put this up there is because now we're finding out that all of a sudden this COVID-19 looks like it really was released in the Wuhan. Now, when this was all occurring, they came up and said, well, that's the only level 5 biological warfare center in the country of China. Oh, and coincidentally, it was this virus originated in the wet market that was outside it. So what a coincidence, huh? But now it's coming out as truth that everyone is believing that. That's the case. An epidemiologist says that credibility is out. They came up and said the genetic sequencing shows that it was made, and they have scientific proof of that. Multiple people are coming out. These thousands of emails came out showing the hypocrisy. And I believe Fauci is kind of a dead man walking in terms of his political career. Why? Because he served his purpose, and like so many people that serve Satan, once their purpose is served, they are done with. I hope that happened to Bill Gates, because he has been thrown to the wayside, discredited now because of his extramarital affair and his womanizing that's coming to the surface now. So don't worry, though. Satan's going to have another one he plugs into the mix at just the right time for his purposes. But right now, I don't know if you're like me, but I do not trust what the mainstream media says. I have a really hard time with it. So you look at that and you're saying, what are they going to lie to me about today? Because obviously, this was an orchestrated media campaign that included all, like the New York Times, MSNBC, NBC, CBS, ABC, were all singing the same tune. And it was a lie. So, I've got to be careful here. I don't know if this one, a video, will be banned or not. So I've got to be very careful about what I say, because I never know when the media, the big media out there, like YouTube or others, might ban me. They've already banned me once on a video, and if they do it again, I'm down for like weeks. But this sort of thing is out there, censorship. And as we get closer to that one world government, who is going to be in league with this media apparatus that's out there, where are you going to get your truth? I know where I'm going to get my truth. The Word of God. And the ones and people that I know and trust within the church. So I think this sort of thing is making us as a church grow closer and closer together. And as a community, draw closer and closer together. Because anything coming through that you receive is often filtered. We only see what they want us to see. And we only get the truth that they want to tell. A long time ago, somebody called the media Satan's little helpers, and I think that's exactly what they are. I leave with a couple of verses here. Joanna and I've been enjoying with Joanna reading through the Bible. She reads it to me every day, and it it's really awesome because what happens is it stops my day, makes me sit down, and I get to hear the Word of God from somewhere that I'm not even thinking about. And that's when it's really nice, because usually when I go study the Bible, I'm studying, I'm looking, I'm digging. But here, I just sit back and it flows. And it's often amazing when that happens, that it meshes with what you're going through in life or meshes with something else I'm studying. Because guess what? The Holy Spirit's in charge. And the Holy Spirit provides for you the food that you need. Just let Him do it. So let me read these about Zephaniah 1:18. Neither their silver nor their gold shall be able to deliver them in the day of the Lord's wrath, but the whole land shall be devoured by the fire of His jealousy. For He shall make even a speedy riddance of all them that dwell in the land. So what is it talking about here as far as the timing? This is the day of wrath, and I'll give a class on that. The day of wrath occurs in the last 3.5 years of that tribulation period. Now, don't think that wrath has not occurred in that first 3.5 years as the Antichrist rules and brings his power and his minions with him that first 3.5 years. But when he sits inside that temple and declares himself God on earth, then he will bring hell on earth. And God's wrath will be upon them at that time. Zephaniah 2:3 says, "Seek ye the Lord, all ye meek of the earth." Now, who's that speaking to? Who shall inherit the earth? The meek. Now, what is another name for meek in the Bible?
Humble.
Someone who's listening in this class. Humble. Humble and meek is the same thing. So, to be meek, to be humble, is a person that has acknowledged who they are in relationship to God. That is step number one in developing a relationship with God, is acknowledging He is the Lord God creator of the universe, and you're not. You are not. You have to realize that you are a sinner fallen short of the glory of God. And you have to humble yourself, being meek and lowly, getting on your knees and acknowledge Him as the creator of the universe. So that's critical. "Which have wrought the judgment, seek righteousness and seek meekness. It may be ye shall be hid in the day of the Lord's anger." And that's what we are hoping for, is being in the day of the Lord's anger. We hope we shall be hid within the bosom of Jesus Christ. Now it talks, when Jesus talks about Lazarus and the rich man, He talks about you will be in the bosom of Abraham. Well, we don't get to rest in the bosom of Abraham, but we get to rest in the bosom of Jesus Christ. Because the reason I say that is because of the statement that says, by Paul, that says, "Absent from the body and present with the Lord." So we will be taken and safeguarded. Our souls will be until the return of Jesus Christ and the rapture. If we die before Jesus Christ returns, He will keep us. Now, the interesting thing I get in this discussion with people on is, well, what happens when you die? Some people, well, we're going to go to heaven. Well, that's not what the Bible says. The Bible says you're going to be with the Lord. Doesn't say you're going to be in heaven. So absent from the body, present with the Lord. So the Lord is keeping you and keeping you safe and whole until the day of the rapture, when you will be lifted up, your flesh will be reconstituted, and He'll put that soul in the dead ones, and they shall rise first. And we that are in Christ that are alive, we shall be lifted up as well. But our flesh will be discarded. I don't know what that means, but we'll get new flesh, and we'll meet the Lord in the air with all the people that you ever knew that were Christians. And that will be a grand and glorious day, because we will be without that sin nature that is dragging us down all the time, without the flesh that's old and freaky, and we'll get that gone, and we'll just be in rapturous union with the Lord our God as we commune with Him. So can I get an amen to that?
Amen.
That's an amen on that one. All right. Now, strange as it may seem, you know, you ever get that song in your mind that goes over and over and over again? You ever get those? And you go, why am I singing that stupid song, right? Because you don't even like the song, but it comes in your brain. So it's in your brain. Well, this point, this week, I reached this point with this verse. And this verse was over and over and over and over. And no matter what I was doing, I couldn't get it out of my brain. And you know what? I didn't mind it that much. It was kind of good. And this is one that my kids learned. Have you ever heard of Moana?
Yeah.
Okay. Well, this is their verse from Moana. For I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believes. And it is just a powerful verse. And I love this because that is really something that we as the believers in Christ, given the Great Commission, need to know that we shouldn't be ashamed of the gospel of Christ, but be proud. Because that is what saves the world. That is what saves us. And it is the power, again, that reaches people. If they do not hear the gospel of Christ, how can they call on the name of the Lord? They can't. So it's our job to get that gospel of Jesus Christ out there so they can hear the name of God and so they can call on the name of the Lord. And we need that more than ever before.